This story is intended for an adult audience. It features language and situations that might not be suitable for all audiences. Listener discretion is advised. In the 1970s, all these really young girls, like 13 and 15, got taken. Maddie whispered suspensively, pausing to inhale a cheap cigarette and to exhale acrid-smelling smoke through a slightly cracked car window before she continued. Zora focused intently as the cherry of Maddie's cig cast an eerie illumination onto her red lips. The parked car was dark. So, it turns out it was a cult of evil people who live around here. They were making sacrifices, letting them get dragged screaming into the bowels of hell, Maddie said with a wave of her cigarette. Shut up, Zora responded incredulously, eyes rolling. How are they sacrificed and taken alive into hell, she snapped skeptically. That doesn't even make sense. The demons killed them, duh. They say the seventh gate goes straight to hell, and they even found one girl's burnt-up torso hanging out of that hole. OMG, Zora said, annoyed, though her anxiety was up and her heart raced a little. She slightly scolded herself for even coming along tonight. I'm way too old for this, she said aloud. Too old for the gates, giggled Maddie. We are only 22. I mean, most of us are, she cast a look at Beau. What else were us broke bitches going to do on a Saturday night? She took a big swig from a bottle of pink Boone's Farm between her knees. We have been doing the same old bullshit since high school, Connor quipped from the front seat of the old Buick. Do you have a better option? He asked as Maddie shrugged. Connor turned around to face them in the back seat. We always drink and look for spooky shit. You have? Asked Beau. Really, babe? Beau smiled, ruffling Connor's hair. I'm sure there are better things to do than scare yourself out here. He winked at Connor. What do you do back in high school all those decades ago? Maddie asked Beau with a smirk. Go to the ice cream social with the gang? Connor raised one eyebrow at Maddie and shot her an invisible death threat, and that she was unable to see, but must have felt and understood because she went silent. I'm not that much older than you, Beau told her as he squirmed uncomfortably for a moment. I'm only 34. I'm sure it's hard for you, losing so much time for your youth by getting knocked up so young. Who has little Joey tonight, Maddie? He asked, feigning true concern. The comeback hit hard, and Maddie squashed her cigarette out angrily, then flicked it out the window. My gran, who is in her 50s, but she still has all her teeth, Maddie shot back. Beau took his middle finger, hooked it under his front teeth, and briefly popped them out at Maddie. Gross. It's a hazard when you're so beautiful you can't get much more sugar than others, Beau bobbed his head at Maddie. I know you couldn't possibly understand. Will you two please stop, Connor injected sharply. I really wanted tonight to be fun. I don't really get this whole seven gates thing, Beau mused. Like, it's just some old train trestles and graffiti-covered walls. And there were only six of those that I saw. It's because no one knows where the seventh is, Maddie said with triumph. Then how do they find a dead torso there in the 70s, Beau laughed. Zora is onto something here. You just wait, Maddie continued. We've seen stuff. There are red eyes in the dark and creepy mist and devil dogs. They say if you get too close to the seventh gate, a black car appears and chases you away. Oh no, Beau said laughing. Not dogs. Imagine seeing dogs on a country road. Must be the work of the devil, Maddie gave him a finger. Zora frowned, annoyed. Well, I hadn't planned on being broken down out here in a smoky car with you jerks. We really need to do something. I have an idea, Connor said. He opened the door and got out of the car. All we really need is a jump, and we can get to a place where we can call someone. Let's hope we get one soon, Maddie called after him. For real, my gran will straight murder me if I'm not back when she said I should be. She had some real concern in her voice. She might not ever babysit for me again. That would be just terrible, Bo said as Zora took the opportunity to escape from them and join Connor at the front of the old Buick. What do you think is wrong with it? She asked as he popped the hood. She walked around in a circle in the road, praying for a signal to return to her cell phone. Zora paused. She thought she saw a shadow move in the woods behind the car. She clicked the flashlight on her phone and looked in that direction. It's my imagination, she told herself, though she could not shake the feeling they were being watched. The battery cables are bad, but it's just completely dead. Connor lifted the hood and looked in woefully. I've never done this before. The dark sky rumbled above them, and they both moaned in frustration. You better do whatever you're going to do, Zora pleaded as the first drops of water splattered onto the dry asphalt of the road. Get back in the car, Connor demanded as more drops fell. Zora hopped back in and her eyebrows furrowed together when he hopped back in as well and slammed the door. I thought you were doing something to help. I did, Connor protested. What exactly was that? Zora said loudly. I put the hood up, he protested. Zora scowled. You know, the international sign for distressed motorist? Now the next people who come along will see us and pull over and give us a jump. You have got to be shitting me, Zora argued. In what universe is that a sign for shit? Who is going to stop out here at the gates of hell for that? Also, now it's darker in here than before, because now we can't see out the windshield. If there are kidnapping demons out here, I'd rather not see them coming, kidded Bo. Anybody, Connor snapped back. Nobody believes that creepy bullshit. Relax and drink your shit and wait for help. Connor, my gran is going to freak out, Maddie pleaded. She said be back by midnight. Her voice began to take on a slight whimper like she might begin crying. Bo huffed a guffaw. Your gran loves me, Connor soothed. I will explain it all to her, he promised. Maddie crossed her arms, turned toward the rain-spattered window, unconvinced. Just great, Zora said, as she closed her eyes and leaned back. The old car began to warm with humidity and the windows collected steam. The rain began to hammer on the roof. Maddie turned to Zora and leaned in close to expand upon how much her life sucks. Zora decided to crack open the warm blackberry manischewitz she hadn't intended to drink in the first place. She silently cursed Connor, who always got them into trouble, as Maddie went on. Zora noticed a strange slurping noise behind Maddie's lamentations, and she sat forward. Zora shushed Maddie and whispered, "Noise." Maddie was silent, and they both heard a soft, smacking, slurping, hungry noise. They huddled together, looking frantically out into the dark, rainy woods on either side of the road. "Do you see anything?" Maddie asked in a hoarse whisper. Zora blinked as a flash of lightning lit up the area. For a brief, heart-stopping moment, she thought she saw several dark figures standing in the woods. In the next flash, they were gone. "Connor!" she gasped as she lurched forward. Then she saw Connor's head moving erratically, and she thought at first he was having a seizure. "Connor!" she asked, leaning forward, both dreading and praying for another lightning flash. Zora strained her eyes, trying to make out what was wrong with her friend. In less than a minute, she went from terror to fury. A sliver of moonlight peeped under the hood of the car, illuminating a complete pair of dentures resting on the dash. She realized Bo's head was in Connor's lap. She slapped Connor on the back of the head as hard as she could. "Why did you do that?" he yelped. "What the fuck are you guys doing?" she screamed, outraged. "No," gasped Manny, recognition crossing her face as she realized what was happening. Tears welled up in her eyes. "Let me out," she screamed at Bo, who looked delighted with himself. "I didn't think you guys were paying attention," Connor began. "You don't do shit like that in front of friends," Zora screamed, hitting Connor again. "Let me the fuck out," screamed Maddie. "I'm going to puke." This proclamation motivated Bo to open the door and pull the seat forward as Maddie fled the vehicle. Zora gnarled a "fuck you" at Bo and followed Maddie into some bushes where she wrenched up the Boone's farm. "Why?" she asked Zora tearfully as saliva dripped a long string from her mouth. "No matter. Connor has always been gay," Zora said bluntly. "He's an asshole, but he's a gay, oblivious asshole, hun." Maddie sobbed openly but nodded. "Hey!" Connor called to them. A dark pickup truck pulled up to the car and stopped. "Oh, thank God," Zora said as Maddie wiped her face. The girls sighed in relief as they returned to the car. A large boy and a red-headed girl in overalls were standing over Connor's engine.
"It's overheated," the boy grunted.
"You need water," the girl agreed. They both had an extremely flat effect, their faces and bodies devoid of emotion.
"Will you give me a ride to get water?" Connor asked.
"No need," the boy said. "Water in the creek," he pointed to the woods.
"No way," Zora said, looking at Maddie. Maddie tightened her grip on Zora's hand.
"I'll get it," said Bo, and he accepted a bucket from the redhead and followed her toward the sound of running water.
"Something's wrong," Maddie whispered to Zora. "Their overalls are painted just like the graffiti on the gates."
Zora looked. Maddie was right. The stranger's clothes were covered in multicolored words and phrases that mimicked the writing on the gates. Zora's blood went cold.
"Connor!"
Zora went to him. "We shouldn't trust these people."
"Knock it off, Zora," Connor told her. "We've been stuck here for hours. I told you we would get help."
Zora desperately tried to get a signal on her phone again. The large boy's eyes followed her as she walked a bit farther down the road. The longer Zora looked at his eyes, the more they appeared to glow red. She shuddered and walked a little further from her friends. Then there it was. Two bars. Zora smiled back at her friends and punched in 911. Her smile faded as quickly as it had come. Zora's flesh went cold, and many figures dressed in graffiti-covered overalls came from the woods and surrounded her friends. Her call turned to grainy static in her ear. Zora turned and broke into a run. Zora's escape ended suddenly as she collided with Redheaded Girl. The last thing she saw before it went dark was the wooden bucket as it smashed into her face. Zora awoke in a tunnel, her face a bloody, swollen mess. Her destroyed nose was not spared the horrific smoldering odor and heat before her. Zora struggled to clear her vision, only long enough to make out the charred remains of Maddie's face, surrounded by red-eyed people in graffiti overalls who only watched emotionless as a shadowy claw pulled her screaming into the fire.